Jackson Heart Study is the largest study of African Americans looking at incident heart disease events. So it took a group of about 5,300 African Americans from the Jackson, Mississippi region and started following them over the past 8 years or so to see who developed heart attacks, who died from heart attacks, and who had to get revascularizations done. And the neat thing is they collected a lot of data from the beginning of the study so that we could then go back and see what predicted those events. What we know about most of the lipids that we measure now is that they, the actual particles that carry the cholesterol around vary in their function and sort of how good or bad they can be. And in particular with HDL, we're just starting to learn about all the things that HDL can do, both to promote atherosclerosis, but more importantly to prevent atherosclerosis. And so from this study, we measured two specific subclasses of HDL and the cholesterol contents within that using the Atherotech panel. The smaller, denser HDL3 subfraction and the larger, more buoyant HDL2 subfraction. And the idea is that by measuring the cholesterol contents, we get a sense of how much of those subfractions are in the sample. And then we looked at the correlations of those subfractions with events in the Jackson Heart Study. And what we found was that the smaller, denser HDL3 subfraction was more predictive of less events. So the more you have of that, the less likely you were to have a heart attack or a fatal heart attack or revascularizations.
Was that a surprising finding, or does that spur you on to want to further research HDL subclass?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think it's important to try and tease out what that means from a functional standpoint. Are those HDL particles, how do they function compared to the ones from the larger, more buoyant subclass? And are they providing some more protective role in the way they function in those individuals? So we'd like to explore that a little more and to see if there's any mechanistic insight that we can gain from this and stimulate more studies. It's important to realize that the basic lipid panel is just giving us an overall sense of cholesterol, but not a breakdown of different types of particles. And we're learning more about these particles and how the different types of particles may have different functions. And to have an idea of how much cholesterol comes from the different types gives us a sense of how much of those particles are floating around. The basic cholesterol panel, while in a broad sense is a good start, certainly has plenty of limitations in terms of picking up risk. If you look at our study, in fact, HDL cholesterol, which is traditionally associated with less risk, lost significance in our population after adjusting for the full model of all of the possible covariates. So I think in breaking it down further, we found that the HDL3 association with less risk was actually driving that trend of HDL and less risk overall. So with the new ATP guidelines, I think we can expect to have some recommendations on how often we should be measuring cholesterol, especially in light of therapies directed against cholesterol and trying to further reduce risk. I think this study doesn't necessarily tell us that we need to measure subfractions just yet. It just gives us an idea of the power of potentially knowing that. But to actually have a clinical implication, we didn't actually analyze the clinical implications of measuring HDL3 in everybody. But I think it starts to scratch the surface of what it means to start measuring some of these subclasses.